دوخ طريق ماي ما پیغام کده برای ما پیغام کده برای ما همو دختری قومای ما پیغام کده برای پیغام کده برای ما همو دختری قومای ما پیغام کده برای پیغام کده برای ما همو دختری قومای ما برای ما نوربند 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 بیا نوربند دخشیده دل ما منده دخشیده دل ما منده همو دختری قومای ما جون مرکلو نوربند همو دختری قومای ما جون مرکلو نوربند
Welcome everyone. We've just had the most wonderful musical treat from Silk Road, and I'll mention a few things about them in a minute. But my name is Elizabeth Ho, I'm Director of the Hawke Centre, and I'd like to welcome you all here, not only on behalf of the Hawke Centre and the University of South Australia, but also our most important partner, the Adelaide Festival Centre's OzAsia Festival. We are delighted to co-present the OzAsia Festival keynote address and delighted that you could be here this evening to hear our esteemed speaker, Professor Amar Galla, on the fascinating topic of safeguarding our intangible heritage. Before we go to the Galla welcome, I do want to say a few things about the performance that we've just heard. This is a performance by Silk Road. They are available if you would like to hire them for any good reason. And they have been a wonderful musical introduction to this evening because, of course, they embody what Amar, to an extent, will be talking about, the value and the importance of encouraging the talents and expressions and enduring cultural knowledge in new lands, knowledge from old lands. The sounds are wonderful, the performers are richly endowed with talents that reflect the deep traditions of Afghanistan and adjacent Asian countries. Now, we come to our Galla welcome. I want to do this welcome in place of our wonderful Uncle Lewis O'Brien. I do so with great humility because Lewis is known to many of you. He is a wonderful man. He is an elder of the Galla people. He is someone that has taught us at the University of South Australia many things about Galla culture, and especially the importance of two-way thinking. The idea of yera, the idea that we should listen to each other, we should take the sum of the parts, we should never have one impose on the other. And I know that this is a sentiment that he holds deep in his heart, and we learn from him. So, in his absence, and without knowledge of his language, unfortunately, I say to you that we are on Galla land. It is land that is deeply enriching and very, very important to the Galla people. And we are, in fact, near to the place of the red kangaroo dreaming. And this is a place of great spirit and great importance. We show our respect to the Galla elders and to all Galla culture members. And we thank them for the opportunity to meet here this evening. And some of you will know how important Indigenous culture is in Amar's work. I'm sure that he'll be referring to that. And I note that in particular tonight, that he sees Indigenous culture as one of the most, possibly the most important cultural attribute of Australia at this time. I mentioned our partnership with the OzAsia Festival. It is the leading Asian arts festival in Australia. We've worked with the OzAsia team over the last 3 years to present this keynote. I'd like to particularly thank Jacinta Thompson, Artistic Director, and all of her team for the shared experience. We have common values to educate and extend community understanding of the depth and reach of Asian and other cultures, and to value how they enrich us, remembering that we belong to the Asian region. I would like now just to mention a few people who are with us this evening and to acknowledge them as special guests. Our Patron in Chief, His Excellency Rear Admiral Kevin Scarce, Governor of South Australia. It's marvellous to have you here. The Honourable Carmel Zollo, MLC, representing the Premier of South Australia. Ms Rachel Sanderson, the Liberal Member for Adelaide. Carlo D'Ortenzio, the Chief Financial Officer for the Adelaide Festival Centre. The Honourable Chris Caracas, Chief Justice of the Supreme Court of South Australia. Alex Brooking, the State Director of DFAT. And Lewis Smith, the State Director of DIAC, and I should perhaps translate those as Department of Foreign Affairs and Trade and Department of Immigration and Citizenship. Also, Judge Ralph Sulio, Chairman of the Australian Multicultural Council. And it now gives me great pleasure to introduce our speaker. The festival, the Hawke Centre and the University of South Australia are delighted that Professor Amar Galla accepted the invitation to deliver this keynote, and we welcome him back home from Denmark. Let me share a little about his background. He was educated in New Delhi, a long-standing citizen of Australia, and a global contributor to multicultural heritage and arts. Amar's career currently encompasses a leading role in the 40th anniversary of the 1972 UNESCO World Heritage Convention, and he also directs the International Institute for the Inclusive Museum out of Copenhagen, and is also a Professor of World Heritage and Sustainable Development at the University of Split in Croatia. He has provided strategic cultural leadership in the Asia-Pacific region as the first Professor of Museum Studies in Australia at the University of Queensland, and previously as Director of Sustainable Heritage at the Australian National University. He has led a national affirmative action program for the participation of ATSI people in Australian museums, galleries, parks, and World Heritage areas. He has been a technical advisor on similar projects in Canada, the United States, Brazil, Vietnam, India, China, Norway, and so the list goes on. He's a past office bearer in the Asia Pacific Executive Board, the Cross-Cultural Task Force, and the International Executive Council of the International Council of Museums in Paris. He was recently elected in Singapore as the Vice President of the Commonwealth Association of Museums. Amar brings a deep commitment to the value of cultural diversity. And when I say a deep commitment, I mean that it's much more than saying, it's nice if people perform, it's nice if we eat food that comes from other countries. It's about a deep valuing of multicultural experience. And he also has rich artistic experience, and we have both of these benefits in his role as our keynote speaker in 2012. He's had a major influence on multicultural policy over many years in Australia, and especially in the arts, and we are deeply grateful for his insights regarding heritage this evening. Please welcome him to the stage. Thank you.
Salutations. Good evening. And my first respects to elders past and present on whose land we speak, listen, engage, entertain, and to all the distinguished people that are here. I've deliberately taken off my glasses. That's because I'm seeing so many people that I have not seen for so many years that I'm getting tears. So it's better that I don't actually, you know, because I can't concentrate if I keep on focusing on so many of you that have been so wonderful in the long struggle to, you know, to promote cultural and linguistic diversity in this country. I'm a storyteller, and there was a time when storytelling was frowned upon by academics, but now storytelling has become, you know, an art form. Storytelling has become an integral part of safeguarding our intangible heritage across the world. And in Australia, the Indigenous Australians have valued this as a very important form for intergenerational transmission of their heritage values. And so did other Australians, the immigrant Australians and their descendants. However, how we value them is very different in the sense that we seem to have, you know, quite rightfully acknowledged the values that Indigenous people espouse, but sometimes we've fallen short of, you know, following the same kind of respect to our own intangible heritage in non-Indigenous cultures in Australia. So I thought, born, brought up, educated in India, 25 years as an Australian citizen, 5 years as a presidential advisor in South Africa, and I've worked in different countries. I'm an old man. And how am I going to engage? What does diaspora mean? What does Asia and Australia mean? I live in Denmark, I'm an Australian citizen, and you know who the most famous Australian in Copenhagen is. It's the Crown Princess. So what does it mean to be an Australian? It's a question that keeps on haunting us and will continue to haunt us for a long time to come. And we should. We should continue to ask those questions. But let me start this way. Before I give you some snapshots of my journey in this country, over 25 years as an Australian citizen from 1985, on the 2nd of October 1985, on the 169th birthday of Mahatma Gandhi, I betrayed India and became an Australian citizen. And then 25 years later, I moved to Denmark. But before I come to that, I did have a past in Australia, not just discos and bush dances, but my first day in Australia, my arrival, it was very traumatic. I left India on the 18th of November, 1977. I arrived here on the 19th of November, 1977. India had, this is before 2004 tsunami, one of the worst tsunamis in my home state where I come from, Andhra Pradesh. Over 10,000 people, including several members of my own family, died. But remember those days, we were still faxing things and, you know, struggling with communications. It was very traumatic for me as a young man to arrive here. But the week before I arrived, the Indian High Commission was burned down in Canberra. The Indian military attaché was stabbed at the golf links in Canberra. So unlike the usual Australian profile on the back page of newspapers in India, cricket, tennis, never on the front page. The only time Australia was profiled on the front page in the 70s in India was when Whitlam was the Prime Minister. Otherwise, Australia did not really count. But then in 77, during the week I came here, it was profiled because all these activities were attributed to the Anand Margis. So I was told my friends who took me to the airport were very generous. In fact, they were cruel because the night before for my farewell party, they took me to see Airport 75 film, which is not a wise thing to do when somebody is flying for the first time in their life. And also, they said, if any stranger comes to you, just be aware. Because it could be Anand Margis, right? That's what was being told. So my first day I arrived, it was a weekend. Canberra those days was like a haunted ghost town if you arrive on a weekend. And I was at the university house, and they said the bottle shop was closing after 1 o'clock. So they said, if you want to buy something, you better go and get something. So I went there. I've never been to a bottle shop in Australia. In fact, it was my first day in Australia. I stood in the queue with my stuff, whatever I picked up. I can't remember what I picked up, but I did. And there was this big man behind me, tall, taller than me. He kept on saying, hello. And I said, oh, hi. Are you from India? I said, yes. Oh, beautiful country. I love it. I said, oh, God. And then he said, what do you think about Indira Gandhi, you know, with the emergency and everything? I thought, oh, my God, he knows about India. And then he kept asking questions about India, telling me about India. And I thought, definitely, an Anand Magi. And I was so nervous. I paid. And then from the bottle shop to the east wing of the university house, I went as fast as I could because I knew he had longer legs than me, could walk faster than me. So I looked back, and he wasn't behind me. And I went into my room, I shut myself, and I had a bronze metallic dancing Shiva from Chennai, and I had it there in case he comes and knocks on the door. I was going to use it to defend myself. And then the following Monday, I was in the Faculty of Asian Studies, and then I was taken to the library, Menzies Library, the old card catalog. I was looking at the card catalog, and I looked up, and this guy was there on the other side. And I thought, he really is following me. And he came up to me, how are you? So nice to see you. Is everything okay? And then he gave me 5 numbers. I thought, that's strange, only 5 numbers for a phone number? He said, if you want, you need anything, just call me. I thought, this definitely is a case to be careful about. So I went to the library to get my first books to borrow them. And those of you being at A knew those days, you know, Mr. Rose and Mrs. Clarkson. And Mr. Rose was always singing, saying beautiful things to women, because he wasn't seen as sexist those days. And he said, oh, you already met the big man. I said, yes, he is big. Who is he? He's following me. Mrs. Clarkson was dealing with returned books. She dropped them, turned around, opened her mouth, and she said, you don't know who that person is? I said, no, I don't. I had no idea. No idea. I mean, look. Does it look like a terrorist? That was my first day in Australia. But I'm going to have some slides. I mean, PowerPoint slides are basically supports for the story that you want to tell. What you see behind me is some amazing Aboriginal people. I came back to Australia in 1984, 85, 85, you know, like I told you, I already became a citizen. And my first job was through the National Aboriginal Educational Committee. I was funded by the Council of the National Museum of Australia, the interim council, my salary, through the then Canberra College of Advanced Education. The chair of the council was the first director of the National Museum, Dr. Don McMichael. My first dean was Dr. David Wright, the founding director of Western Australian Museum, or when it expanded from 3 people to 169. And this is the first job that I was offered. But it was a challenge. It was a challenge for several reasons. One is I had an all-Aboriginal, you know, reference committee, very powerful. About 18 women and one man, and they made the one Aboriginal man the chair, so he didn't have much say. That was just amazing educationalists, who is who in Indigenous education. But I want to acknowledge and recognize one of the greatest Aboriginal educationalists that the present generation of young people might not realize. His name is Mick Miller. The Miller Report of 1985 transformed Australian Indigenous education. Until 1985, Aboriginal people were allowed, remember I'm using the words very carefully, allowed to become nursing aides, teacher aides. That's what they could do, or what indigenous people call jackies, you know. But that report transformed it both for the schools as well as, you know, higher education in this country. And I was privileged to be appointed to establish the first ever mainstream, mainstream educational program. But there was a particular target. That's why the National Museum was involved. There were at that time 14,600 people on the payroll of museums, galleries, libraries, archives, national parks, World Heritage Areas, heritage councils, right across Australia. Quite a large number. Remember, these are the generous days in the cultural sector. But there were only 6 CEPs, which means, you know, Community Employment Program people. That included Aidan Ridgway, the Australian Museum, and Peter Yu at the Western Australian Museum. And only 1 Aboriginal employee in a museum in this country, none in the parks. So how does somebody educated in India run a national program in Australia? My chair of the academic board for the program was Professor John Mulwaney, one of the greatest Australians that I was privileged to work with, and had an Indigenous committee. And money was not an issue. Money has never been an issue in Indigenous affairs in this country. Delivery and often the middle people have been a challenge in this country. So that's how I started my career as a migrant, even though I'd been in Australia before. But why I'm telling you this is what is now called intangible heritage. We didn't call it that way. We didn't call it intangible heritage. And what we did was, they sent me around for 18 to 19 months to understand, study, you know, indigenous ways of dealing with heritage from an indigenous point of view. Peter Yu helped to, and Pat Dodson, to draft indigenous terms of reference. And a number of people like Peter Sutton from the South Australian Museum at that time, Chris Anderson, and very distinguished anthropologist Professor Diane Bell, who's sitting there, you know, and I haven't seen her for a long time. All these people played a very important role, and it was a collaboration. But the question came up several times, but he's not white or black, but what's his interest in indigenous things? And a very wonderful archaeologist called Wilfred Schofcross, who very dramatically said in a meeting, well, Amar is neither white nor black. He belongs to the third ethnicity, and we need somebody from third ethnicity. Remember, these are the days of ET and third kind. So it seemed like I, you know, came from the outer space, but it was an advantage. They wanted me to do what I was doing in India, what I learned in India, because at that time, there were Aboriginal people on what were called work information tours going to India to study how Indigenous people, Aboriginal people, scheduled tribes are represented in the Indian Parliament, 7% in the cabinet, have affirmative action, something that Nehru coined and borrowed by the rest of the world, thanks to the Canadians for making it, promoting it in 1950. How do they participate? Is it possible to have Indigenous representation in Australian Parliament? I think we still haven't got that. So there was this kind of respect by Indigenous people towards people who are educated in India and come from a background where they had first-hand knowledge of tribal knowledge systems. So in going around Australia and trying to work out, what I came up with was a study program, which was entirely driven in such a way with Indigenous terms of reference where there was no difference between tangible and intangible. It was integrated. There was no nature culture, the kind of Judeo-Christian dichotomy that informed the colonial sociology of knowledge. So it was holistic. There was no movable and immovable. It was a holistic approach that was taken. What you find is some of the graduates there. There's Noel Nanop. He's retired. I'm still going, but he was my student. He's a Noongar elder from Geraldton area. Barry Hunter, you know, one of the top guys in Queensland with the liaison between mining and indigenous communities. But what we tried to do is that how do you get, how do you get behind the kind of establishment, if you will, sort of in Australia. And this is a performance in a display case at an exhibition at the Asian Civilizations Museum in Singapore. I thought this, in a way, signifies what we were trying to do in the 80s in Australia. And there's Brian Durance, curator of South Asia collections at the British Museum. And you think he looks very guilty? He does, doesn't he? And he's sitting next to his object. And the object is looking at you. But really, I mean, what you're looking at is the object. But do you know who is behind the object? Which community, which voice, which stories? You know, what values, what intangible heritage? So what I found in Australia is that we were looking at objects, we were looking at sites, but we were forgetting the people behind them. I'm talking about 80s. So the whole curricula, the whole program was driven integrating intangible heritage. We didn't call it at that time. We were focusing on Aboriginal knowledge systems at that time. But it's very sexy to say intangible heritage these days. And that's piercing the mask, getting behind the site, getting behind the object, behind the artwork was the challenge. But if there was no difficulty working with Aboriginal elders across Australia, to help us with developing the curriculum and delivering the program, that was quite easy. But it was a huge challenge because it didn't fit into conventional categories of this is anthropology, this is archaeology, this is history, this is sociology. So it became a huge challenge. So we developed this whole framework, which is now taken for granted in Australia. But at that time, we called it cultural heritage management. Initially, we tried to say cultural resource management, but Marcia Langton said, don't use resource, because then people think it's something to be used, but it's something to be valued and passed on. So that's why we called it cultural heritage management for the first time in universities in Australia. And the Nobel laureate Chinua Achebe, I'll let you read it for yourselves. And how many of you have seen a snake in your life? Oh, and not rainbow serpents. And what do snakes do every year? Shed their skin. And what he's saying is, are we collecting the skins that snakes shed and let the snakes go by in our museums, in our heritage institutions? Where is the spirit? Where is the life? Where is the living heritage? And it's true that not all collections can be associated with living heritage, but a lot of them could be. And so that in a way, to give you another context that, we were looking at the framework. And how many of you sort of drank tea with your grandma? Put your hands up. Or coffee, whatever. Ooh, that's great. I work in Vietnam quite a lot, Afghanistan, Vietnam. I was working with 32 young people. Then I doing this Young People in Heritage Conservation pocket handbook. And it was really shocking because out of 32 people, only two people had grandparents, knew what grandparents. Because for the 30 others, they died during the American War. In Vietnam, you say American War because they had many Vietnam Wars. And so how do you deal with heritage when that happens? How do you deal with heritage when you're dealing with indigenous people who've been removed? Out of the 286 indigenous Aboriginal Torres Strait Islander students that I dealt with, and the staff, seven indigenous staff I dealt with, 2/3 were brown babies. How many of you know Bobby Randall? Bobby Randall, the brown baby, the song and the guitar. Bobby was my tutor. He worked with me as a tutor, he himself was taken away as a baby, So how do you deal with heritage when you're dealing with indigenous people who did not have that, that privilege, that honor, that dignity of the heritage being passed on from their parents, grandparents, to themselves when they were taken away as babies? So it was a huge challenge. But I just want to say this, that if you were to ask your grandma, grandma's teapot, what value grandma's teapot? Grandma, your teapot is very special. It's very old. It's of great heritage value for Australia. It should be in a museum. A grandma has, you know, some amazing watercolors from way back. Grandma, these paintings, these artworks are so significant, they should be in a gallery. Grandpa was in the war. He wrote beautiful love letters. And grandma has these love letters. Grandma has grandpa's diaries. And you think, oh my God, this is documentary heritage. It should be in an archive. Grandma has the first editions because her grandpa was really keen on collecting the first, all the books that were published. But these are of such value, they should be in a library special collection. But grandma's house was built in the 19th century, like so many, you know, in South Australia. Grandma, this house, it should be conserved and maintained. You know, we need to put it up for listing and Heritage Council. And if you talk like that, what would grandma think about you? She'll think all that education that you got has done no good to you. Right? That's what grandma would think. Because you forgot about grandma's voice. You forgot about grandma's values. You forgot about grandma's language and idiom and diction. You forgot about the folk life that grandma is familiar with. You forgot to ask her about the whole range. You forgot to ask grandma, what kind of lullabies did you sing to my mother, grandma? You forgot all those things. You didn't ask. And that's what we've been doing in Australia for a long time. That, you know, so what we've been doing is we're focusing on the, you know, we have to put the people in the center, but it's only now we're doing. So we focused on the tangibles, the sites, landscapes, sculptures, structures, objects in museums, artworks and galleries, documentary heritage and archives, and so on and so forth. But we forgot about grandma's voice, values, traditions, and so on and so forth. But we also forgot that it doesn't matter if grandma's life was informed by Judeo-Christian value system, that grandma still was very practical, which means grandma had a holistic perspective about life, nature, and culture together. Like indigenous people did not make that binary opposition between nature and culture. And so how do you take this holistic view? And this diagram was drawn in sand at the Crocodile Hole near the Ruguna Aboriginal community and near Turkey Creek by the old people, you know, how they saw it, and we translated it. My name is there, but it says PU, that's Peter Yu. Peter and I worked together on this, and he's a very prominent Aboriginal leader in this country, along with Daryl Kickard. And so this is how we developed this whole program, integrating that intangible heritage is an integral part of the total way of, say, looking after our heritage. And only then we can start thinking about who we are as Australians. But also importantly, even though I was working on this at that stage, mainly with Indigenous staff and students, I opened up the program with the support of my Indigenous committee. Everybody said, oh, you're stupid doing that. You know, it's not wise. This should be just for Aboriginal people. But my worry is it's a national program that if you isolate them in the study place, when they're going to the workplace, they would be the only black fellows. How are they going to work in the workplace? So I wanted to integrate that. That's why I was in a Faculty of Applied Science, the first mainstream program in this country for Indigenous people. Because the whole idea is that, you know, building the skills and competencies and building the dignity and self-esteem so that they could work in museums, national parks. And these former students included the first 32 Aboriginal rangers, first Aboriginal rangers ever to work in Kakadu National Park. And so I just wanted to share that because it is one of the mistakes we make in this country as a migrant. And especially ever since moving to Denmark, I've become even more conscious of it. Sometimes when you move away, you reflect, you know, sort of on your own country far more than you do when you're surrounded by things, is that what we do, what we aspire to do so well when we deal with Indigenous heritage and Indigenous values in this country, we forget to extend the same kind of respect and honor to all other cultures, immigrant cultures in this country. You know, we talk about, like, for instance, you look at living heritage systems in this country, we have one of the best institutions in the world when it comes to Indigenous people, Australian Institute for Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander Studies in Canberra, in terms of ethics, in terms of resourcing, in terms of knowledge. There's nothing like that in the world outside the United States. And yet, we don't value the same way in our knowledge systems about, it doesn't matter what you want to call, Anglo-Celtic, German, Indian, whatever, you know, all other cultures that were brought to Australia. We, you know, and I think that if you really have learned, if you're really committed to Indigenous principles of knowledge, and we have learned from them, they should be extended to the whole of Australia. You know, that's the way you build mutual respect. That's the way you promote intercultural dialogue. And so that's, but I want to share this with you. This is also copyrighted by Peter, you and myself, because we found the police were using it for the wrong purposes. This was drawn in the sand. Carmen Lawrence established a task force when she was the premier to review all cultural institutions in Western Australia. Professor Tom Stanage, a very eminent historian, was the chair, and the chair of the Indigenous committee was Peter Yu. You name it, who is who was on that committee, you know, sort of Pat Dodson, Daryl Kicker, Darlene Oxenham, Jackie Oakley, I mean, amazing Indigenous leadership from Western Australia. But I was brought in every weekend, every Wednesday, you know, I flew back to do my teaching in Canberra as an advisor to the Indigenous committee. So when we actually met Kimberley Aboriginal people, the elders, we asked them, do cultural institutions mean anything to you? The old people listen to us. I mean, I'm talking about, when I say old people, you know, I keep thinking about the old, that African saying that when an old person dies, a library burns down. These are walking encyclopedias in the Kimberley of World Heritage Value. Amazing elderly people with cumulative knowledge of generations. So they drew this in sand. You know, Carol Martin, who was in the Western Australian Parliament until recently, was facilitating this. And they started off here because this is contextualized within the Royal Commission into Aboriginal Deaths in Custody, because Pat Dodson was one of the commissioners and he was chairing and facilitating this process. It says colonization, displacement, and disposition. I mean, this is in various, you know, Bardi and various languages, but it's been translated into English. And so colonization, displacement, and disposition, loss of economic and subsistence-based access to land, and loss of heritage consciousness and breakdown of cultural self-esteem, and cultural discipline, erosion of cultural self-esteem, grieving, hopelessness, and use of negative recreation, internal violence within oneself, within the community, domestic violence, community violence, use of negative recreational drugs, and custody and control, deaths in custody. So Daryl Kickett, Peter, you and I said, come on, tell us, where do you see the role for cultural institutions? Anybody wants to tell which box that they picked? Anyone? Erosion of cultural self-esteem. They did not talk about loss of access to land, because that's part of the cycle, vicious cycle that they were dealing with. The young people don't feel good within themselves. I've used this diagram. You know, in the United States, the keepers of treasures from National Park Service and the National Museum of the American Indian, they all used it because they said it applies to them. But it equally applied to those young white kids on drugs in King's Cross in Sydney. They weren't black, but they're white. They were also struggling with the same thing, that erosion of self-esteem. So that's how they saw the whole context. But you can't deal with erosion of self-esteem by tangible objects and sites, intangible heritage, living heritage, that knowledge system through intergenerational transmission, you know, passed on by the carriers and transmitters of those heritage values from one generation to the next generation. Next generation is critical to make one feel good within oneself. But also, unlike the frozen object or site, living heritage is living, it's dynamic, it's not frozen in time, which means it's adaptive, it's creative, it's, you can you can really deal with the next generation without shoving it down their throats. So when I finished the affirmative action program, I went off. I took 1 year, and in fact, I'm still moving on. I was at the Smithsonian for a while, working on the equal opportunity plan, advising the formation of the five presidential networks in 92. You know, they have national months, presidential months for Native Americans, Hispanic people, African Americans, Caucasians, and Asian Americans. So Office of Multicultural Affairs, the good old Office of Multicultural Affairs, asked me to pull everything together and published it as guidelines for the sector. And we did that, and Peter Yu, Des Griffin from Sydney, a number of people helped me to do this. I couldn't have done this on my own. But here I just want to mention, this brings us into multiculturalism. I don't know how many of you were in 1988 at that amazing Arts for a Multicultural Australia workshop that Eugene Yasulis, who's sitting here in the audience, you know, convened at what was then called the Jam Factory. You know, it's now the Line Center, right? And because if you look at the National Agenda for Multicultural Australia, launched by Prime Minister Bob Hawke, I'm here courtesy of the Hawke Center, so I acknowledge with gratitude for the leadership that Bob Hawke provided. In 1989, National Agenda for Multicultural Australia was launched. Page 49 is where Eugenia and her leadership was implanted, because in the drafts of the National Agenda, culture was not mentioned. And cultural institutions and culture was mentioned on page 49, thanks to that Adelaide meeting here and the inputs from that to Canberra, to the Prime Minister's office. So here is another part of the journey dealing with intangible heritage. So what you see, you know, is some of the objects. I mean, there's a mix of indigenous and immigrant material that you see here. Right at the top is Hong Hai, you know, which is in Darwin, and with the Vietnamese refugees. And but also on the other side of the report, which I don't have the image, is a beautiful image from the Latvian Cultural Center Museum here, another one from the Lithuanian Hall here, is my engagement. I never thought of, you know, when I left India, my mother said, "Why are you going to Australia?" I said, "Oh, they want me there." And she said, "Yeah, but, you know, what are you going to do with," because my mother's knowledge, like most Indians those days, was very limited about Australia. "But you're not into sheep farming and wheat farming. You know, that's not your interest. Why do you want to go there?" So I told her what I was going to do. She said, "Oh," she always thought I was mad. And there's a song in my mother tongue, "Pichi Pichi Pichi Manishkoka Pichi," that is, everybody has their own madness, but to each one, their own madness is sweet. Right? So my mother thought, "That's okay. You enjoy, you know." But she said, "Listen, one thing, you told me there are people from 160 countries in Australia." I said, "Yes. Don't shack up with Indians." And I said, "Why?" She said, "You idiot, you're going for a few years, mix with all those 160 groups, learn as much as you can about the rest of the world." So I hardly know any Indians in this country as a result. And because I really thought that I wouldn't be here for long. And that's the best thing that I ever did. But then, you know, in connecting with the immigrant, the cultural diversity side of things, I kept on applying the same principles that I applied, you know, I learned from Indigenous people, I shared with Indigenous people, and I facilitated the same principles. And James Jupp, you know, those of you who know Encyclopedia of Australian People, once famously said, "Australia has never been able to say all cultures brought to Australia are equally valid," quote unquote. We still haven't. No policy document ever said that. And so that's the line of approach of mutual respect and so on. But what I want to move on from here is, in 1994, I had this amazing fax that came from the Minister for Culture, the Minister's office in South Africa, with the new dispensation, the democratic government led by President Mandela. It was from Winnie Mandela inviting me as the opening keynote speaker for the first post-apartheid cultural convention at the Parktonian in Johannesburg. I freaked out. I'd just come back from South America after doing a two-week intensive for all the National Museum directors as part of the International Year for World's Indigenous Peoples, 93-94. I thought, there's a mistake here. So I faxed back and I said, I think there's some mistake over here, very politely, you know, not declining, but saying that there are many other people who could. Then they faxed me back 9 pages saying why they decided on me. I went. And the next 5 years were like an amazing journey with the leadership of Madiba. And this, I wanted to share this with you about intangible heritage. This is the first presidential project that Mandela funded in post-apartheid South Africa. It's called Swaying. Swaying is the Pretoria salt pan just outside Pretoria, about 2 hours outside. And it's one of the second largest meteorite craters in the world. The other one is in Arizona. But it has 120,000 years of archaeological evidence because there was salt, the animals came because of the salt, and the human beings came to hunt the animals, so the story goes. But it's an amazing crater. But surrounding the crater, in 1954, there were four Boer farmers. In 1994, when Mandela became the president, there were 2.4 million blacks. There were all the blacks that were removed from Transvaal and dumped. Now, when you talk about Soweto, southwestern township of Johannesburg, there's black municipality, segregated municipality, appalling standards compared to Sandton in the white municipality. But they still had water, electricity, sanitation, very poor kind quality. But in Swaying, there was no water, no electricity, no sanitation, nothing. A human dump. And you know, when you drive through there or when you walk through there, the dust with the dogs and goats and human beings, the feces, it's 5 to 10% fecal dirt. And these are the conditions in which, you know, Mandela inherited, you know, this place. So the first million rand was given how we could use, because under the apartheid regime, blacks did not need maths or science because maths and science were not funded for blacks. So in Swaying, this whole township, new high schools and primary schools were being built, but we didn't have the money, you know, for laboratories, you know. So, but here is a crater with, you know, incredible, you know, range of bird species, you name it. So it became our open air laboratory for high school students. It's called Swaying, a place of salt. But what was really interesting is, how many of you know about Indibele? Indibele people from Southern Africa, there are quite a few because we had many exhibitions in Australia. The Indibele king, he basically said to me, you know, we're still not free. I said, what do you mean you're not free? Oh, look, we have got God in Mandela. We've got freedom as a country, but my people are still not free. Because during the 50 years of apartheid regime, they were forbidden from initiating their young people. Because initiation ceremonies were seen as being subversive, they were banned. And so they could not initiate. So the first thing they wanted to do was, you know, an initiation ceremony as part of this whole cultural project that Madiba was funding. And that's what it is. So then the king said, you're the only non-Indibele here. I want you to photograph everything and tell the rest of the world we are free. So then the president's office funded it, and I did a traveling photographic exhibition of this. And these are images from that exhibition. See, boys are with the mothers. Their primary socialization is with the mothers. So the mothers, at the time of initiation, where they're put in a kraal, you know, for 13 days, and as they come out, the mothers don their best, the blankets, the beads, and everything come out, because the boys are becoming men, to hand them over to the men. And they're all coming out of the kraal here. Once initiated, you know, they got the, you know, the beads and the whole status that goes with initiation. And it was sunrise, early in the morning, they're coming out of the kraal. And what is this? This is intangible heritage that was denied to the people, and it became very critical. And for people to feel good about themselves as to who they are. So this kind of integration, here is an Indian from Australia, you know, going and facilitating this process. And I just want to say, when we say we are Australians, we are many peoples. We are not locked into, you know, one kind of essentialist ethnicity. And I want to very quickly, you know, sort of other projects that informed by this commitment, passion for intangible heritage that I learned from Indigenous people of Australia, and that was applied was in Vietnam. This is Halong Bay, which is a World Heritage Area. There are 10,000 fishing communities. Right in the middle, you see a floating museum for safeguarding intangible heritage. And totally run by local people. I lived there for 2 years training local people. And this is the celebrations at the opening. And one of the things that really bothered me those days was there were so many people. I mean, this is when I met a wonderful man that I didn't know who he was. He just used so many foul four-letter words in the camp near Yuendamu. I thought, I don't want to spend time with him. But later on, I realized what a great human being he was, because he called anthropologists and government bureaucrats as those bastards all the time. And you know who it is, Fred Hollows. And so one of the things that Fred taught me was that don't ever forget that not everybody is privileged. Because when you talk about intergenerational transmission of heritage values, you take certain things for granted. So this is a project I did in India with the National Museum students, and it had a global impact. And next to me, there is the president of National Blind Association. The first thing he said was, people spend more time trying to be politically correct to say, you know, vision impaired, this and that. I am the president, I'm blind, I know it. So just say it and get on with the damn thing. And my students did a fantastic exhibition in the National Museum of India. That is, if you cannot see, you have four other senses, but, you know, they're accentuated. So how do you those accentuated four other senses, you know, in order to create an experience? And what role does intangible heritage play in creating those experiences? And that's what this project was. And this is something that we were extremely conscious in the Indigenous program over here. And I want to share this, and they've all been blurred, the images, because this is a project that is ongoing. I was recently given the Human Rights Award from New South Wales government for this. And Cooma, how many of you know Cooma? Yeah, you all know the Snowy Mountain town, you know, birthplace of Australian multiculturalism and all that stuff. But Cooma also had the second oldest prison in the colony, because in Parramatta Gaol, you know, sodomy, as it was called, sodomizing was a crime. So all those inmates in the early 19th century who were sodomizing, according to the documentary records, was sent off as far away as possible into the Blue Mountains, also into the Snowy Mountains, to cut the stone and to build their own prison. I mean, if I were there, I would have built larger cells, but I believe they didn't have a choice. But so what one of the guy over there at the top, the correctional services officer over here, Les, it was after his great-grandfather that you have Mont Kosciuszko named. He's Polish, of Polish descent. He's in charge, and he applied to study with me at ANU. I said, well, why don't you work on your assignments within the museum? Then some of my other students at the top, they worked with the inmates. It so happened most of my students were female, but we went into the prison, the students, they sat in the cells with the inmates. Never once was there a catcall or anything like that. They were treated with dignity and respect. And so we built the world's first museum that's built entirely by inmates, and it's entirely run by inmates. There's not another one in the world. I was the former vice president of International Council of Museums in Paris. I did a lot of research to see, is there another one to create a cultural exchange? We have a lot of prison museums, goals, and you know, we interpret them. But it's not a living museum. So this is a living museum with inmates inside. So how do you tell the story of corrections? So the line we took is very simple. What is Australia's, you know, non-Indigenous history? It's the history of corrections, right? I mean, it's a significant part, but how do we tell the story of corrections? How do we tell that through the first voice of the people who are inside rather than outside? That was the whole approach that we took. But why do you see Pioneer Women's Hut over there? In 1988, when the European or whatever you want to call bicentennial was being celebrated, the boys forgot that there were also women in the colony for 200 years. There was very little funded for women. And so the Country Women's Association in New South Wales, led by Wendy Hucker, used the Manus prison, women's prison that was abandoned, recycled the materials and built the Pioneer Women's Hut, which became the National Small Museum of the Year in 1988, awarded nationally. And I couldn't take the inmates across the border into ACT because we have legacies from the colonial times, almost pre-Federation times. The law has not changed. You cannot take the inmates across. You hand them over. Two attorney generals have to sign off on that. You hand them over. So I thought these women, what they did with very little money, they're the best trainers. So we trained the inmates with the women from the Pioneer Women's Hut. And so, you know, national quilt registry is maintained by the Pioneer Women's Hut. They know about conservation of textiles. If you work in a prison, you know that textiles are very important. And Kuma is also very famous for its leather craft. And so that's how we did that. But we put emphasis on, you know, Australia's continuing heritage, the stories that are passed on, the stories that inmates have told for a long time. You know, it is incredible. It is so popular. Kuma, which was on the decline, has been revived, and the prison museum has become the hub for reanimating Kuma and its heritage values and tourism. So tourist buses come here, school groups have booked out this place, and school kids, when they come in, they love it because they don't want to talk to the correctional services officers. They want these tattooed inmates to take the classes for them. But we do have a problem, because ever since we opened this 5 years ago, people who still got 7 years, 6 years to go, they're going on weekend detention within 1 year, which means they're leaving. So succession planning has become a major issue. So I just wanted to share that intangible heritage is not just something romantic out there. And I want to, this is the National Museum in Phnom Penh. Some of you might recognize it. I mean, one of the things when I was an advisor there, going there regularly as an advisor, I said, look at these young Buddhist novices there. They're sitting inside the National Museum courtyard. So you have all these amazing sculptures and everything, Buddhist sculptures. Buddhism, you know, especially Theravada Buddhism and, various philosophical systems are alive in Cambodia despite all the horrible things that have happened, you know, in that country. But why are we not dealing with that living heritage of Buddhist communities? Why are we still dealing with this minimal caption, Western hegemonic aesthetic object in a museum? So trying to bring, you know, sort of the Buddhist sculptures together with living Buddhist communities in Cambodia was a huge challenge. It's always good to have students who go as Australian youth ambassadors and do some of the volunteer work. And I deliberately put this because we're right now dealing with a lot of controversies to deal with Islam. And I think this is going to be one of my last stories because I'm going to wind up. And when I first got into museums, I left Australia, India. And when I went to the Metropolitan Museum in New York, I was a young man, I was shocked. There was a beautiful image of Krishna, you know, sandstone sculpture from Mathura. Krishna, 7th century AD, Mathura, that's it. It was in a glass case. Poor Krishna couldn't breathe, you know. And for me, coming brought up from 20 years from a rural area, it was so disrespectful from the Metropolitan Museum. And I was very depressed. I thought, do I really want to have anything to do with these bloody colonial institutions? I was walking down the steps. And then there was this, you know, Hare Krishnas going down the street. They looked at me. They said, you must be Indian. I thought, oh, you must be smart, you know. But they were shoving a Gita in my hand, Bhagavad Gita, saying, everything is there. Don't go into that museum. I mean, that notion of a text is antithetical to Hinduism. I mean, the book is important in Christianity and Islam, but in Hinduism, there's no book. There's no containment of this, that one book has everything. So I thought, okay, these people have taken over Krishna too. You know, go on, these neo-colonialists. And I was a neo-Marxist coffee house, you know, those days. So you always saw everything as colonial or neo-colonial. And then I was cataloging the early Buddhist collection at the British Museum, and I found that Krishna is an archaeological object. Then I go to Leiden, to the Institute Kern, to do some work there for a couple of weeks, and to Music Gime, Krishna is an anthropological object. I thought, that's it. This is terrible. And then now, in India, in Mathura, which is the area associated with Krishna, there's intangible heritage projects with the stories, the love songs, the paintings, even the Kangra paintings from Himachal Pradesh, associated with Krishna's life, which have been passed on. Very significant intangible heritage that's being studied. Oh boy, poor Krishna. I mean, you talk about who is an Australian. Krishna had struggles. He doesn't know who he is. Because what we do in museums is we decontextualize, we capture, we imprison, you know, in the archives, in our display cases, in our collections. We don't let those objects breathe, you know, in their context. You don't have to take them back, you can still have it in the museum. That's what intangible heritage is about. And the reason I put this up is, unless you are driven by the idea of the text, unless you're driven by the idea of the text, a lot of religions have tremendous sense of humor. I was brought up in a predominantly Muslim community, and I grew up in Andhra Pradesh. Tremendous sense of humor, the way you joke about things and everything. Right? And we've lost that sense of humor. This is a very popular, you can read it for yourself. This is Shiva. Right? You can joke about it. I mean, you can joke about Shiva, Krishna, how naughty he was with his 18,000 women. You know, who was said, you know, Hinduism is monogamous. But I think that the sense of humor that we need to put in, which was there when we deal with intangible heritage. But another aspect that you remember September 11th, 2001. This was on the 6th of July, 2001, in Barcelona. I founded Asia-Europe Museums Network. In fact, Australia is a member now. Why did I do it? I found it very frustrating for two reasons. One is, in Europe, they could tell their own story about European heritage in all its diversity, but they could also tell, because of colonial collections, about Asia. But in Asia, we could tell about our stories, but we couldn't tell anything about European civilization, right? I mean, if you went to the National Museum of Ethnology in Japan, in Osaka, you think European civilization was all about medieval plough agriculture. They never progressed anything beyond that. That's all the collections they got, and that's what they present. So this asymmetry of collections, how do we deal with that? But in doing that, what I said is, you got tangible collections, we have the intangible heritage. How about we marry the values, voices, and traditions that inform the collections that you got with the source communities, and we form a partnership. Everybody thought I was a little bit crazy, but Ambassador Delphine Colomé from Catalonia helped me to launch this. Within 1 month, we got $3.5 million from the Asia-Europe Foundation. We haven't stopped. We just had a meeting in Seoul. Why did I do it? I felt that if you're very much focusing, essentializing yourself, saying, I'm indigenous, I'm Indian, I'm German, I'm, you know, whatever, Welsh, you want to say, then in a globalized world, you don't exist by yourself anymore. You really have to take it that in a global context if you want to safeguard living heritage. Because whether you like it or not, the accelerated pace of globalization is steamrolling, road rolling, everything. So that's one that's success, that's continuing now. And this is the other one that What I found is that when I was president of International Council of Museums, 90% of people in the Pacific Island countries are indigenous people. And they, for them, living heritage, intangible heritage, is their sense of what they're dealing with. But because the whole focus is on object-centeredness by anthropologists and archaeologists, that's never been promoted. So we formed the Pacific Island Museums Association to integrate intangible heritage. Now we have a triangulation with Australia. You have the source communities in the Pacific Island countries, you have immigrants and their descendants, including the descendants of our own form of slavery, that's the South Sea Islanders. And here, and the collections both in Australia and their countries, we're doing this triangulation to bring tangible and intangible heritage together. And this is my book that's being launched in Kyoto, Japan, on the 8th of November. And I just love this Ni Vanuatu kid, you know. And this is the Chief Roy Morto's domain, World Heritage Site. It's a World Heritage Site that is actually about intangible heritage. The landscape is a World Heritage Site, but everything is about the legacies of Chief Roy Morto. So what I'm doing is somebody from India who never left India, like a frog in a well, I came here. You know, I'm so grateful to so many people that I'm able to do these things. And I finish off with Afghanistan. And this is me. I mean, I'm a Republican, so you never see me in front of a Union Jack, okay? But it's a media conference with the British ambassador. I had no choice. And in Kabul, when we return over 2,000 objects from seized by the British customs in 2009, back to the Kabul Museum. About 70,000 objects were stolen from the Kabul Museum during the storming and looting of that place. But it's not so much about returning and training people, but it's actually this place. You all know about Bamiyan, right? That's where I'm working right now. And what you have is the Buddha statue, that's the greater one. And the cavity there, all the murals are stabilized thanks to German expertise and Italian expertise. But this is the Great Silk Road. You heard the musicians, Silk Road. It's the Great Silk Road. There's the cavity there for the larger Buddha, the smaller one there. That's the Silk Road. So what I've been doing for the last 3 years is working with the Hazara community here, but also Tajiks and the small number of Pashtuns. How do you deal with the living heritage of these people? It's very easy to focus on the Buddhas because the BBC has this whole debate for the last 2 to 3 weeks. Should the Bamiyan Buddhas be reconstructed? And they're not in the near future as far as people like me are concerned. More importantly, local people are concerned. They're so poor. If you're going to spend $26 million rebuilding the Buddhas, you know what will happen to them again. So working with them, what's really interesting is there's so many, you know, Atam, Bushkoshi. Bushkoshi is the sport that led the Kashmiri kings to develop horse polo that the British then introduced to the rest of the world. So they still have these traditions, and they play them, they celebrate them. And then Pushpa, which is only for women, you know. And so this is what I'm doing as what I learned from here as an Australian, as an unhyphenated Indo-Australian. And I don't have security there. I go for long walks all by myself. But at the end of the day, when I talk about all these places, what I do, you know, the French cuisine is on the representative list of UNESCO World Intangible Heritage. Mediterranean cuisine is on it. Kimchi is going to be soon on it. And there are 10 spices that made a difference in the world. When you travel like I do, I mean, sort of, when I was on the SBS board of directors, I always used to joke about my work saying, you know, really all this poverty alleviation, community development, it's an excuse. I was so poor, I really wanted to eat all those nice foods on the world. My dream was to go on a world food safari. And of course, they got a food safari program that came up. But the intangible heritage of food is very significant. So when we talk about Mediterranean cuisine and French cuisine on the representative list of UNESCO, what would we put, you know, unless we're talking about bush tucker, what would we put as Australian cuisine, which Australian cuisine? Is there something that's uniquely Walt as Australian cuisine, as our intangible heritage? And I still think of, when I think of uniquely Australian, I think of possum magic. You know, so Lamingtons, pavlova, Vegemite sandwiches, quintessentially Australian. But what is Australian? And why we need to do this? The next generation. It's as simple as that. We have no choice. Because if we don't deal with the living heritage, we're leaving inanimate objects, inanimate sites that we're interpreting, even if you do period costumes and interpreting. But young people are caught between two worlds. They want to be hip and cool. You know, they're very nerdy. They're, you know, they're really savvy with their internet savviness is unparalleled. And but on the other hand, they're also looking for meaning. Intangible heritage is about providing that meaning, you know, to what we do in Australia. I have three daughters, all of them at university, and one doing a PhD. And her PhD thesis is on the sociology of conflict between animal rights and artistic rights and performance art. When you got in Denmark, you know, a performance artist standing there with a blender and goldfish, and the audience come and you put the goldfish in there and press the blender, that's performance art. So whose rights are you talking about? Artist rights or animal rights? So that's what she's dealing with. But their mother is German from Hamburg. But these girls are born in Australia. They're Australian kids. They're not Indian or German, but they're Australian. So what does it mean for them when they talk about their sense of place and identity as Australians? And that's why I do what I do. And I'm very proud of it. But before I finish, I want to tell you one last story. And that last story is to do with SBS. It's not public. You'll have to wait for the archives to release with under the law. But I'll tell you. We were meeting in Perth. In fact, we're meeting in Perth in April 2000. Our MD got a phone call from Ray Martin. And it was devastating for us, some of us on the board. Why? Because the year before, myself and others, we talked to the Council for Aboriginal Reconciliation. We wanted to cover on SBS radio and television. We wanted to cover Corroboree 2000, right? Remember the Sydney Opera House meeting performances, the walk across the Harbour Bridge, right? But Ray Martin said that they, and also the Council bureaucracy in Prime Minister and Cabinet, said that, look, ABC has greater spread than SBS, which is certainly true, and that they would like ABC to cover it. And so we said, that's fine, but if there's anything we could do, we would like to work with you. Those days, ABC working with SBS? Oh. But what happened is, 5 weeks before, 27th of May, before Corroboree 2000, Jonathan Shire pulled the plug for ABC. ABC was not going to cover it. So we got a phone call. We were actually in the board meeting in Perth. So I said, we're going to cover it. Everybody looked at me like, are you mad? 5 weeks before the end of the financial year, or 6 weeks, whatever, we're towards the end of the, we're going to cover it. But I must acknowledge that SBS had amazing people. So Peter Kavanagh, the director of television, said, oh, Amar, I can talk to, you know, Mary Costa-Kiedis, Yana Wendt, and Indira Naidu, they will support us, all the engineers will support us, they will volunteer because it was on the weekend. Kwong Lu, head of radio, he said, the OB van is free. If it's not free, I'll reorganize it. We'll have the OB van. We'll use the radio for promoting this. Maureen Crow, head of resources, was quickly doing her sums. Amar, you know how in all the departments and institutions, there's always leftover resources towards the end of the financial year. We can do this. So we did it. How many of you have seen the march across Sydney Harbour Bridge? A lot of you have. We covered it. The only thing we didn't have was a chopper, so Ray Martin got us a chopper. So we covered it. And why I'm saying that is, as an Indo-Australian, I'm very proud about my commitment to, you know, reconciliation in this country between Indigenous and all other communities, and intangible heritage. It plays a very important role. Unless you deal with living heritage, you'll always be divided by the binary of us and them, because you're objectifying, you're freezing, you know, indigenous people, you're freezing everybody else. But the living heritage is a powerful civic space in which we could have intercultural dialogue, interfaith dialogue. We can facilitate intergenerational dialogue to pass on our values and value traditions to the next generation. Thank you very much.
Stay here.
Stay here. Now I can see you all.
Ama, you have freed our minds. We're unfrozen. Before I invite Professor Palalualia, Acting Deputy Vice Chancellor at the University, to offer a vote of thanks, I would just like to again acknowledge the wonderful performance by Silk Road. I would also like to mention the work of my team, Louise Carnell in particular, in making tonight possible, and Jacinta's team, which has a number of people in it, but again, without their support, it would not be possible. Ama, thank you for coming, and now Pau will formally thank you.
We both are Indians. Which except, Indians?
Except I'm from Africa. So there's a big difference. Look, Amar began the lecture today talking about the fact that he is a storyteller. And I think what we've heard tonight is a brilliant story about our intangible heritage. But I'm also a theorist, so I guess I always want to take what somebody's saying and try and encase it in some way to make sense of what was going on. And I think what really particularly came through for me was that museums are always, particularly ethnographic museums, are of course always battlegrounds. And what we choose to put in a museum is always contingent on the decisions a person's making, what sort of reasons they put into that particular place. And I was particularly reminded of one of my favorite writers, Stephen Greenblatt. He was a new historicist who always talked about these two elements at the heart of our responses to things in museums. And Greenblatt said the two things that were really important when we look at an object in a museum was either, their first response is always the awe, you know, the aesthetic realm that is immediately evoked by a particular kind of object. But then there's always this resonance that what is the connection to us? Where did this come from? What are the people? What are the kind of living elements that Amar so eloquently spoke about tonight? So I guess the kind of debate that we've heard tonight is always this kind of debate between history and aesthetics. And almost every exhibition worth viewing, I believe, has those two elements in it. You begin with wonder and always end up with resonance. And I think that's what we've seen here tonight. We've begun with wonder and we've ended up with resonance. So I'd like to take this opportunity on behalf of the University of South Australia, the Hawke Centre and the OzAsia Festival to thank you, Amar, for a brilliant lecture.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.